Today on Eat Sleep Nerd, video games!
Welcome back to Eat Sleep Nerd, a place where you can check out Go AFK and relax with us as we discuss all things nerd. I'm your dorky DJ, Corey Winter, and in this episode, we're discussing all things video games. Specifically, we are going to predict every single one of the winners for this year's The Game Awards 2023. But, in a special surprise thing we're adding to our agenda, the Grand Theft Auto 6 trailer has released early, so we will be reacting to that live. So, joining me is my nerdy brother Josh Winter and our geeky friend Jason Summer.
Also live.
Remotely live.
And but still live.
Idaho. Yes.
I mean, won't be live by the time they see this, but it's while we're doing it, we're live.
Yes, we are right. Alive. Yes,
relatively live.
Right.
Relatively asleep. We are alive. Right. So we're gonna make this super cash. We're not gonna pretend to be experts on all these video games we're talking about today, but we're gonna be just having a nice, fun conversation about video games. So how are you guys doing before we even get into it? You guys doing okay? You guys doing well? It's back to our original trio here at
Eastland. Did you notice I'm starting to get into the Christmas spirit?
Yes, I did.
With that. My stormtrooper.
Oh, I didn't notice they were stormtroopers.
And yeah, the resolution might be a little low for that one, yeah, dog.
Darth Vader on my. Yes.
That's pretty cool. That's pretty cool. Have you noticed my Christmas Lego wreath here on the desk?
I did. It's a Lego wreath. I didn't know it was Lego. That's cool.
Yeah, it is. Yeah, it is.
Ooh, Josh, do we have a sponsorship?
No, but oh. I was hungry on the way here. And I got a delicious Pepsi from Taco Bell.
Not a sponsor. Mm.
So yes. If I were hungry and wanted some Pepsi, I should probably go to Taco Bell?
Yes, it's one of the few things that me and Pete Davidson agree on. So you should have Taco Bell.
Not a sponsor.
Not a sponsor.
We should totally but hashtag we'll take your Taco money. Bell.
Yeah.
Hashtag so, the Taco Bell.
To be perfectly clear here. The lack of a sponsorship is very one-sided. We're open to it, Taco
right.
Bell.
Taco Bell, call us.
Hit us up right. on the Instas.
Great.
Or DM us.
The snaps. The snappus.
Okay.
Swipe right.
I want right. to want to give a shout-out to my t-shirt. It was a happy accident. It's a GTA, not GTA t-shirt. And we're talking about GTA, which I didn't plan for. So.
Did that say Super Mario Brothers?
Yeah.
Super Smash Brothers, funny. Actually. Yeah.
Oh, sorry.
Brawl City.
Brawl.
I've had this t-shirt for like 10 years. I've never worn it. Just happened to put it on tonight. And there we go.
So let's talk about that for a second.
Yeah.
So this is not when the Grand Theft Auto trailer was supposed to come out.
Correct. This GTA 6 trailer was supposed to come out tomorrow, Tuesday, December 5th.
We are recording on the 4th, as, you know, context clues would tell you. I mean, I guess this is kind of inevitable. I feel like the last few Grand Theft Auto trailers were leaked.
Yes,
before they were supposed to come out.
Yes, that's what happened. They found out that it leaked, so they released it early. So
if you're going to watch it early, you might as well watch the real one.
Yeah. All right, yeah. So it's already tomorrow in like half the world. So correct. Is it based off that? Or is it
no,
really?
No, it was,
no, it was a worldwide launch time. Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, I think it's just, you know, it's going to be one of the biggest games in history. Doesn't matter if it's going to be good or bad. Just because of what it is, it will be one of the biggest games in history.
Yeah.
The same as Grand Theft Auto 5, same as Red Dead 2. It was going to come out early. Mm. And I like the way Rockstar handles it when it inevitably comes out early.
Gotcha. Yeah,
they always just say, you know what, here it is.
Yeah, let me pull up the tweet wheel over the X. The what do you call them?
The X, yes. The message on X.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, so Rockstar Games tweeted out or X'd out about an hour message. Ago as of this recording.
Yeah.
That their trailer has leaked, so please watch the real thing on YouTube. That was as short, sweet, to the point as it could be.
Yeah, that's how you should handle it. Like, it's, like I said, why have people watch the gritty, horrible,
low-res one?
It's out. Here it is. Just go ahead and watch it. Again, they had to know it was going to leak.
Yeah.
Like, it's, anyway. So, I'm excited. I haven't seen it yet. We're going to watch it live.
Yeah, and Josh was on the way here to record this episode when it found out that the trailer leaked. So, like, this is brand new information for us. So, yeah, we're recording this live reactions. I've kind of already seen it, but It's fine. So yeah, we are going to try including this trailer in our video here on YouTube, youtube.com/@eatsleepnerd. But before I publish this episode, I will make sure there's no copyright strikes against it. So if the final episode does not have this trailer in it, well, obviously it's because I removed it. So I'm going to try including it here.
Okay.
It does feature a song by Tom Petty, which might be what copyright striking things do flag.
The Heartbreakers?
I think it's just a Tom Petty song, like specifically Tom Petty.
Okay.
But no, here we go. We're going to watch this GTA 6 reveal trailer. 10 years plus in the making.
Wow. That's pretty impressive. I hope it's good. Already looks beautiful.
Lucia, do you know why you're here?
Bad luck, I guess.
The city, though.
That's pretty sick.
Okay, it looks stunning.
Yeah, it does. The character models, the landscaping detail, the lighting.
That looks real. The plane, that not so much, but... This has got to be Florida.
Like, that looks real. Like, that looks real.
Yeah. Back. Oh, yeah.
We're going to get through this.
Weasel News.
By sticking together. Being a team. Trust?
Trust.
All right. So that was about a minute and a half.
It's good. Looks really good. It looks like a movie I'd like to watch, honestly.
Right. So a lot of big takeaways from that 1 minute and a half long trailer. Obviously, the big one coming in 2025. So we still got a little bit more than a year to wait for it. I think some financial predictions came out for the company from Take-Two Interactive. They said that they're expecting a big influx of cash in late fiscal 2024. So early 2025 calendar year. So probably March.
That tracks.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But just graphics alone, holy crap.
Yeah, it looks good.
Forgot that the team that made GTA 5 also made Red Dead Redemption 2, which was gorgeous. So
yeah, every AAA title has come out of Rockstar North.
Yeah.
Which is the studio that's making this one. It's very, and this is something that we always talk about with these big AAA titles. So you have to assume this game has been in development since Red Dead 2 came out. At least.
At least in full. Like they probably started pre-development, at least a small team before that.
So you've got to be thinking 5 to 8 years this game has been in development. But it doesn't feel dated.
Yeah.
Which is a big thing that other studios like Bethesda, for example, struggle with. They work on their game so long that by the time the game comes out, it looks dated.
Yeah.
But even things like this is clearly supposed to, the vibe of the trailer is that a lot of it's made up with like what's supposed to look like TikTok videos.
Yeah.
And things like that. That is a very prescient, very modern thing that's happening right now. Mm-hmm. When this was started 5, 6, 8 years ago, that was not a thing.
Yeah.
So it's cool that they've been able to adapt and do this. And also, a lot of things that we had leaked before were confirmed. The biggest one being it's in Vice City.
Yeah.
Which is awesome.
Yep.
And I love that they've kind of leaned into the Florida man-ness.
Nice.
That comes
all right,
into.
So I was right. I didn't know it was in Vice City.
You know what I'm saying? Like, okay. Yeah. Like it's, we're leaning into the ridiculousness of Florida. Mm-hmm. And I mean that with all the love in the world. I love Florida. But we're leaning into the ridiculousness of Florida, which pairs perfectly with the pseudo parody-ness of Grand Theft Auto.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So this is cool.
So that was one of the big things about why this game took so long, if you believe all the rumors and stuff. Traditionally, Grand Theft Auto games have been made by two brothers, Dan Houser and Sam Houser. But one of the brothers left, I believe it was Dan Houser, left in the middle of GTA 6 development. And one of the reasons was because he thought that it was kind of hard to make a game that's so centered on parody, because real life is pretty parody right now.
Yeah.
So it's kind of hard to make a game that's making fun of real life when real life by itself is already pretty ridiculous.
Ridiculous, yeah.
So I'm glad to see that there are still some of that traditional GTA 6 satire type of stuff in the vibe of this. Another big thing that was leaked with the big leak a couple of years ago, it's confirmed that we are playing as a female protagonist and potentially a secondary male protagonist, kind of like a Bonnie and Clyde duo, mm-hmm. which is kind of cool. So we're kind of bringing back that character switching we saw in GTA 5, but also recently in the Spider-Man 2 game with Peter and Miles. But apparently the female lead will be the primary protagonist, which is new for GTA.
Yeah.
Which is what we're looking at here. That character model, that's the main protagonist. And that looks awesome.
Yeah, it really looks great.
Yeah.
And like traditionally GTA scene
looks beautiful.
Yeah, like traditionally GTA trailers, like there's no rendering or anything. Like it's in-game footage that you're seeing.
Yeah, they don't pull the swap.
Yeah.
You know, there's a lot of big games like Cyberpunk, for example, had a ton of E3 footage, and then the game came out and it looked good, but it did not look like what E3 looked like.
Yeah.
Yeah, there was a daylight shot. An overhead shot where it just looked like it was an actual live shot in this trailer. It was with the plane going over, mm-hmm. the prop plane going over.
Yeah, Jason, can you see my screen right now?
Yeah.
I think it's this scene right here, or maybe it's the one where the bridges.
No. It's later.
Yeah, the bridges come up. Yeah. Well, let's go and look at this one. So, if you're listening on podcast, I am doing some like screen grabs from this trailer. So follow us over on YouTube, youtube.com/@eatsleepnerd to see what we're talking about. But so this is the first big wide shot we see of the city. They have not really confirmed what the map size will be compared to previous games, but just this one shot right here, the city area looks massive. So I'm assuming at least 2 times, maybe 3 times the size of GTA 5.
Oh, easy.
But like, look at the detailing. Like the beaches are populated with all these people and umbrellas and stuff. You got all those trees. I mean, buildings for miles and miles.
Literal miles.
Yeah. But there are a few more scenes I want to look at real quick. We do have this like Everglades shot right here with like the what do you call it? Hovercraft type of thing.
Swamp boat. Right.
With Deliverance.
Right.
A lot of people were wondering if they were actually going to bring back wildlife, which has been relatively quiet or not quiet, but unused in GTA games. Obviously, Red Dead Redemption 2 went pretty hard in wildlife. So it seems like with all these swans and stuff, there will be a lot of wildlife.
We see some gators and some flamingos.
The gator coming into the convenience store.
Right.
Yeah, we'll get to that in a second.
Yeah.
But like, look at the detailing on the grass. Like you can see individual leaves and stuff.
You know, it's the grass and the trees, the water, that actually looks real. The flamingos, while excellent, do look a little computer generated. A little glossy.
I'm sure they're relatively low res or else it would crash.
But still.
But I mean,
they're not bad at all, but
I think the first shot that really blew me away was this one right here. So this beach shot where the entire beach is full of people.
It's very dense. Yeah,
it's very dense. And I don't see a single character model that's duplicated. Like every single model is unique.
Mm. Yeah.
Yeah, that's a good point.
So, I mean, my God.
But the people still look a little rubbery.
You look a little rubbery.
Whoa.
What?
Whoa.
What do you mean?
Oh, Jesus. I'm just kidding.
A little plasticky, a little glossy. I don't know.
No, I mean, I don't know.
I mean, it's really, really good. But I mean, I think what it is the scenery and the backdrop looks so good.
Yeah.
That the people stand out as computer generated a little more.
Yeah. People are always going to be the weakest link.
Yeah. Well, it used to be water, if you'll recall. Like water used to be like the hardest thing to animate.
Yeah. So I'm skipping around a little bit here. Like we got a live shot, well, not a live shot, but like a shot of nightlife here in Vice City. Full streets, lots of cars, lots of awesome lighting. So it's definitely not going to feel like an empty city, which is cool. I think this is the shot you were talking about.
Yeah, this
Jason.
Is the shot. Yeah, this is it.
Like that is beautiful.
Is this like going off into the Keys? Is that what that is?
Yeah. So surprisingly, the map of this game has not leaked, but ever since that big leak from a couple years ago, people have tried to like piece together what the map could be based on like location data and stuff. And so the thinking is that there's going to be one giant downtown area, which is obviously Miami. Then there will be two smaller cities, plus like four itty bitty cities, and then a whole bunch of Everglades and countryside and stuff like that, which is probably what this is right here.
And then you've got the ongoing rumor that post-game support will include additional areas as they continue to develop. And then it will add and expand to the map.
See, I hesitate to believe that because they said the same thing for GTA 5. GTA Online was originally supposed to include past games like Liberty City and stuff. Never happened.
Yeah.
So we'll see about that.
It's also been like 15 years since Grand Theft Auto 5 came out.
Yeah.
I'd like to know what the soundtrack is going to be like. I mean,
I know. So that's
the 90s, maybe with Tom Petty.
I don't know. Like, if you think about like the TikTok and stuff that we'll see here in a second. Like,
oh, that's right. Yeah, that's
like it's modern day.
Yeah, like there's a lot of things that, like, for example, that when we saw that photo of the Strip, there was some kind of retro-y looking cars, right? But then there's
just a very Miami thing.
Yeah, see, that's what I was gonna say though. Retro is just part of the culture.
Yeah, it looked like there was a Twitch or Discord feed.
Yeah,
going.
See, like that's what I'm saying. So much of this looks like supposed to be modern. I don't think the time period is supposed to be anything other than modern, or contemporary or present day, whatever the word is.
Yeah, that alligator is hilarious.
Yeah, the alligator. Yeah. Let me see some police doing a raid. There were a couple of shots in here where I was just blown away. And yet again, we're talking a lot about graphics and stuff. There's a lot more to this game, obviously, than just looking pretty. It obviously is a very feature and gameplay rich game.
But again, that's a hallmark of Rockstar, though.
Yeah.
Is that their games always push what's possible.
Yeah. Like but this also, right here. I mean,
yeah. Yeah, that looks really good.
This is not the specific screen I was looking for, but like that looks next to realistic. The character model, like, yet again, I didn't stop in the right frame, but that's the lighting, like the detail on the like the face and stuff, like that's incredible. And it still has a year before it comes out.
Yeah, which means they'll probably spend time cleaning it up too.
And like this one, yeah. Anyway, so that's that. I don't think there's any other big takeaways. I mean, we could break down every single frame, but and, there's you know.
Yeah, lots of things that will probably be important in retrospect, but it's hard to say what they mean now.
Yeah.
It definitely speaks to how popular Grand Theft Auto Vice City was, though, that they're going back to it.
Yeah.
It was always one of my favorites.
Yeah, mine too. Until they lost the rights to their soundtrack.
Well, that's a different problem.
Yeah.
I had our background pulled up and I just didn't use it. Whoops. All right, so... All right, so that is GTA 6. Obviously, we'll be talking about that one when it comes out year plus from now. But I'm sure a lot of details will come out between now and then. But in the meantime, let's talk about some Game Awards 2023 this year.
Yes.
Let's talk about that.
So when does this thing happen? December 7th, I see. Is that enough? I think that's enough.
Thank you. You may be seated. Thank you. Thank you. All right. So the Game Awards 2023, they are airing this Thursday, December 7th. It's become an annual thing. I think it's like who knows how many years it's been going on now. Jeff Keighley is the host of it. He's put it together. He organizes all of this stuff. Obviously, the awards, the games, and the developers and directors and all that stuff, they are who are the big, you know, highlighted with the night, who's winning all these awards. But there also are big game announcements and first looks and stuff like that to be expected at this show. But obviously, we don't know what of those things we're going to be seeing. So in the meantime, we want to predict the award winners. So we have obviously not played all of these games yet. We may never. But I just want to see if we can predict what all of the critics voted on. So it is important to keep in mind all of these awards, the winners, were voted on by official publications, not fans. Okay, so these were publications like IGN, GameSpot, you know, et cetera, who voted on the winners of these awards. So we have about 21 that we'll be talking about. There's actually about 30 categories, but there are some categories like esports teams and esports coaches and stuff that I don't think we have any insight on whatsoever. So we'll be skipping those. So instead, we'll be talking and focusing specifically on the best genres. So best action adventure games, best RPG game, best multiplayer game, but also stuff like best director, best narrative, and stuff like that. But obviously, best game of the year as well. So are you guys ready for this?
Let's do it.
All right. So first up, we are talking best action adventure game. So the games in contention are Alan Wake 2, Marvel's Spider-Man 2, Resident Evil 4, Star Wars Jedi Survivor, and The Legend of Zelda Tears of the Kingdom. So remember, we are voting on who we think is actually going to win, not our favorite. But if you want to mention who your favorite is, go for it.
It's going to be a toss-up between... Are the two major contenders are going to be Spider-Man and Zelda?
I think they're going to give it to Spider-Man because I think Spider-Man is going to lose Game of the Year. So this will be a consolation prize for Spider-Man.
Yeah, so to define best action adventure, it's the best action adventure game combining combat with traversal and puzzle solving.
Yeah.
So traversal, I don't think you can top Spider-Man's traversal.
This is true.
It's pretty amazing. No pun intended.
I didn't even consider that. So I was thinking it's probably going to go to Zelda, Tears of the Kingdom. But Jason, you make a good point.
I'm saying Spider-Man.
See, the reason I wouldn't choose Spider-Man is because it didn't innovate enough from Spider-Man 1, I don't think. Like, yeah, it added the web wings and it made a bigger city. But for the most part, the mechanics of the game were pretty similar to the first game.
I don't think that's ever mattered.
I don't know. I don't know if changing it is a requirement of whether or not it should be in contention or not. The web wings, I think, they added a significant improvement to the gameplay. I mean, they're not just like a thing that's like, oh, hey, cool, web wings. It's like, no, you use them. And they have aspects of the game that are specifically designed for the web wings. So it's not just like a gimmick. It's an important part of the game.
This is true. So I did pull up Metacritic scores just to see if we're kind of feeling what the critics were feeling. Zelda Tears of the Kingdom had a 96 from critics. Marvel Spider-Man 2 a 90. So, does that change your feelings?
No, it's still going to be Spider-Man.
All right, so Josh is saying Spider-Man.
Okay, let me ask you. Now, I've not played Zelda. I played Spider-Man. I ran into a lot of glitch issues with Spider-Man's graphics. Did you?
Not that I recall, no.
Like, I actually, like Spider-Man clipped out, and then I fell through the earth, and I fell until I died. Several times.
I do remember there being some significant patches within the first couple of weeks that did address stuff like that. So
yeah, this was last week.
Oh, God.
But do you have the interwebs?
Huh?
Do you have the interwebs?
Yeah. Well, I don't think it should matter. Anyway, yes. Anyway, just wondering if there was some graphics issues. Yes, interwebs, yes.
To me, I had a perfect experience with the game. So.
Have you played Zelda at all?
Not this one, no.
Okay. Josh, any Zelda?
No, I've seen lots of videos on it. I know they added like the build your own contraption thing, which is pretty innovative. That's a pretty big deal. I even saw people like building the Enterprise with it, which is awesome.
All right.
I'm just saying though, I'm looking at this beyond just this particular category. Mm-hmm. I think this is going to be the consolation prize for Spider-Man because they're not going to give it Game of the Year. So they're going to give it best in whatever category it's nominated for. So I don't think it's necessarily that it's the best action adventure game. I think it's the category it's going to win.
Okay. So Jason, what was your vote?
Politics, Jason.
I know. Yeah. No, it just, All right. I think there's something to what Josh is saying. I'm going to say that Spider-Man will probably end up winning for that reason. I'll say that. I'll go with that.
Because like I said, I'm happy to tell you the game that I think should win every category, but I'm also going to tell you the game that I think will win.
Yeah.
What about Corey? Corey?
Oh, I already marked Zelda. Yeah.
But I'm
Zelda all the way.
Oh, that's right. You just said Zelda. Yeah.
Zelda probably should win, but I don't think they're. I don't think it's going to.
There is the whole. I mean, a lot of this, I think, could be recency bias. So, like, Zelda happened months and months and months ago, mm-hmm. but games like Spider-Man 2 and Alan Wake 2 are a lot more
just
recent.
Came out. Yeah.
So I don't know if Zelda had just come out too, would it be a little bit more favored? So that's what I'm kind of thinking. I'm hoping that critics have actually remembered how good Zelda was when it came out.
Nope.
Okay.
Nope. Okay. All right. Well, I'm saying Zelda. So let's move on. Best action game. So we have Armored Core 6, Dead Island 2, Ghost Runner 2, Hi-Fi Rush, and Remnant 2.
Mm.
So to define this, it's the best game in the action genre focused primarily on combat.
Yeah, I'm going to say Armored Core.
Just say Ghost Runner 2.
Ghost Runner 2. Interesting.
Yeah, I think that had a pretty good following with the first one. Okay. And I think people definitely were looking forward for a second one. And I think Ghost Runner 2 is going to get it.
All right. All right. I want to give a little shout out to Dead Island 2 there, because everyone thought that was going to be trash. And here it is, getting a little nom. Look at that. High five.
It was a pity nom.
Oh, no. All right. Let's move on to Best RPG. So this category is a tough one, but I think it has a clear winner. All right, best RPG. We have Baldur's Gate 3, Final Fantasy 16, Lies of P, Sea of Stars, and Starfield. And it's noteworthy because this is Starfield's only nomination.
Yeah.
Starfield low-key was not great.
I put so much time into it.
I mean, it was good. It was good during your first playthrough.
Yeah.
And then in a weird way, the mechanic that was supposed to open it up to replay actually made me not want to play it again.
Yep.
Which is weird. It should be Baldur's Gate 3.
It has to be Baldur's Gate 3.
No,
if they don't pick Baldur's Gate, they're going to pick Final Fantasy.
Yes.
I would not be surprised either way. It should be Baldur's Gate 3.
I think Baldur's Gate 3 is too niche.
Really?
Like,
it's
I was
Dungeons
seriously,
and Dragons.
Right. No. But it's like seriously
they might as well
Dungeons
have
and Dragons.
Invented RPG.
No, but that doesn't make it.
It is like, the RPG.
No. Like it is, you're right. By definition, RPG, yes. But it is such so RPG that I think it gets mired down in being original RPG rather than doing a good job converting the tabletop gaming to a video game platform. It's very good. It's excellent. But I think it really just kind of it ekes out your normal average gamer.
Shenanigans. Baldur's Gate 3.
I'm going to say Final Fantasy 16.
Yeah, Josh and I.
Like I said, if they announced it was Final Fantasy whatever that is, mm-hmm. XVI, I'm actually really good at Roman numerals.
Why do you get derisive when you're speaking against something? You're like, it's Final Fantasy 16. You're just like, whatever that is, Final Fantasy XV, whatever that is. You got derisive.
It's like I said, if they announced it was Final Fantasy, I would not be surprised.
I think I would.
I really wouldn't. It's because Jason's not wrong. If you're super into RPGs, Baldur's Gate 3 is like a dream come true. If you have zero familiarity with a legit RPG, mm-hmm. it can be very different kind of weird.
I think it's a little intimidating initially.
It's on the nose. It's a little on the nose.
Yeah.
It's a video game that really wants to play like tabletop D&D.
And it does.
And
really
it does,
well.
For better and worse.
Yeah.
So, you know, I get what you're saying. It is a fair thing to say that it's a little niche.
Well, yeah.
I think its popularity maybe defies its niche.
Possibly.
But is it factually the best RPG this year? Absolutely.
Mm. All right.
I like how you're like, and my credibility is that it's factual and it's Baldur's Gate 3. Yes, what I say is factually. Yes.
If you speak eloquently and say factually, people have to assume that what you're saying is true.
I'm going to have to work proclivity back into my...
Yes.
back into things.
All right, best fighting game. So we have God of Rock, which I have literally never heard of, Mortal Kombat 1, Nickelodeon All-Star Brawl 2, Pocket Bravery, and Street Fighter 6.
Okay, so let's just say Mortal Kombat 1 and move on with our lives.
I don't know. I think Street Fighter 6 has this one.
You think
really?
So?
Really? Why do you
I
say
think
that?
So. It was a much better game, and Mortal Kombat 1 had a lot of problems at launch.
a whole lot of problems at launch.
Have you played either
game? Mortal Kombat 1 has such broader appeal, though.
Mortal Kombat 1 had a 3.9 user review score on Metacritic. It is, a lot of people did not like this game. In contrast, Street Fighter 3.
But those aren't the people who vote, though.
Even then, critic scores 92 on Metacritic for Street Fighter 6 and 82 for Mortal Kombat 1.
But it was also the second highest rated. Yeah.
What are the other games rated at?
God of Rock was a 62 from critics, and All-Star Brawl 2 was a 78 from critics.
Pocket Bravery didn't have a rating.
Yeah, did not have a rating.
But interestingly, it was the highest rated by people.
Yeah.
Hmm.
Which is probably why it was on there.
Pocket Bravery, I'm assuming it's a phone game.
I'm not sure. I mean, Pocket would
indicate. Yeah, like it's a phone game, right?
But no, I'm sticking with Street Fighter 6.
I'm going to say Mortal Kombat 1. All right. Based on what was it? I don't sport, but they just did the college football championship brackets, yeah, or whatever.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
One of the things they weight is history of the team and who they played against. Mm-hmm. So it doesn't matter whether or not, I mean, it does matter, but it gets weighted along with what their record was and everything else. So this kind of is the same thing, and I hate that Nick isn't here for my analogy, but Mortal Kombat 1, it's the granddaddy of all fighting games. They had a big relaunch reboot this year, and it wasn't terrible. I think it could be fighting game of the year.
All right. I think it's obviously between those two.
On pedigree alone.
Yeah. It's obviously between those two. Jason, what do you think?
What is the Nickelodeon one?
Nickelodeon All-Star Brawl. Two.
Just because I've never played another one. I haven't played any of them, so I'm just gonna say Nickelodeon. That's gonna be my call. Okay. Just for the heck of it.
All right. Yeah, he's going for the wild card.
Yeah, one has a fighting chance. All right, best family game. We have
Super Mario.
Yeah.
It's Super Mario.
Yeah. Disney Illusion Island, Party Animals, Pikmin 4, Sonic Superstars, and Super Mario Brothers Wonder.
Super Mario Brothers.
Yeah. I think Pikmin 4 has a good shot. But it is hard to beat a Mario game.
Super Mario Brothers.
So Josh is seeing Super Mario Brothers. I am too, obviously.
Yeah.
Jason.
That's three. Yeah.
All right.
I said that.
That was easy. All right. I just want to check. Oh. All right.
Gosh.
So now we're getting into best sim/strategy. So we have Advanced Wars 1 and 2 Reboot Camp, which was supposed to come out a year ago, but got delayed because of the Ukrainian war. Cities Skylines 2, Company of Heroes 3, Fire Emblem Engage, and Pikmin 4.
It'll be Pikmin.
I'm saying Pikmin.
City Skylines.
Interesting.
It's a bold claim, Jason.
Yeah.
It is a very popular game, but it was not reviewed very well.
My Beast of a Machine played it just fine.
Okay.
There were a lot of people who could not play it.
Yeah.
Like just on launch could not play it.
Because it was too beefy of a game?
Yeah. Like it's, and I mean like my machine played it on minimal settings. So, which again, I mean, it's a next-gen
game. Are you flexing your machine?
No, that's what I'm saying. Oh. Like minimal settings for a legitimately next-gen game. I mean, it looked great.
Okay, gotcha.
But if your computer's more than 4 or 5 years old, it was not going to play that game.
Yeah.
It just could not. So yeah, there are a lot of people who are disappointed. So as much as I would have wanted that to, and I think if it had a better launch, it could have been, it's not going to be game of the year. Not for that category.
Mm. All right.
All right. All right, let's move into best sports/racing. And I want to give a high five to Jeff Keighley for combining sports and racing into one category, because Madden doesn't need to win these games anymore. I mean, come on. There's the same thing every year. You don't need all these awards. Anyway, so
just
we got
add people and yeah, they change right. out people.
So we got EA Sports FC 24, which is what replaced FIFA. We have F1 23, we have Forza Motorsport, we have Hot Wheels Unleashed 2 Turbocharged, and we have the Crew Motor Fest. Gosh.
Murder Fest.
So many R's. So yeah, we got a couple of, I mean, really all of them are racing games except for FC 24.
FIFA!
I mean, I don't know a lot about this category. I know that Forza is always good and people always rave about it. I'm going to say
always Forza. Race about it.
Yeah, they always race about it. So yeah, I'm going to say Forza.
Yeah, I'm going to say Forza too.
I'm going to say the FIFA. FIFA.
It's not FIFA anymore. They lost those rights.
It's FIFA adjacent.
Yeah. Yeah, I would say that was probably going to be my second pick, is the football club one. All right, best multiplayer game. So we have Baldur's Gate 3, Diablo 4, Party Animals, Street Fighter 6, and Super Mario Brothers Wonder.
Diablo.
Yeah, I'm on Diablo.
Like,
okay.
Like, it was one of those that it's almost one of those where if you play it solo, you're weird.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
And like, this was not a strong year for multiplayer in general, which I high five.
Yeah, I know. For thank God.
Single player. But in a year of not a lot of multiplayer, I think Diablo 4 really stuck out.
Yeah.
But what's what's the definition there for best multiplayer?
For outstanding online multiplayer gameplay and design, including co-op and massively multiplayer experiences, irrespective of game genre or platform.
Irrespective. So
what a broad definition.
So you can play with other people.
Right.
So yeah, I think we're all in agreement on Diablo 4.
Yes.
Is there a close second, do you think?
Probably.
If it was going to be a second, it would have been Baldur's. Yeah.
Okay. I agree.
Yeah.
All right. Best game direction.
Okay.
So now we're moving into just the more production side of things. So best game direction, we have Alan Wake 2, Baldur's Gate 3, Marvel's Spider-Man 2, Super Mario Brothers Wonder, and The Legend of Zelda Tears of the Kingdom. So to define this category a little bit, it's awarded for outstanding creative vision and innovation in game direction and design.
Alan Wake.
Interesting.
So the technicals are always, again, I'm looking at this beyond what it's literally for. The technicals, no, I mean, I'm being serious. The technicals are where you give awards to movies or video games where you want them to have an award, but you know they weren't best picture. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? So like Alan Wake is not going to win Game of the Year. It's just not. But does everyone agree Alan Wake is amazing and is a follow-up to an amazing game? Yes. So we need to give it an award. So that it can say it's an award-winning game. Because it should be an award-winning game. But we're not going to give it Game of the Year. Here's your best game direction.
I mean, I hear you, and I agree with that. But I have to give it to Baldur's Gate 3 just because...
Oh, no. I'm not saying Baldur's Gate 3 shouldn't have it. It should. That is a feat. That was a massive undertaking with a gajillion parts that had to fit together.
And it worked.
And
there were no bugs.
It launched. It was a fully functioning game at launch. And that doesn't happen anymore.
That's why I'm giving it to Baldur's Gate. Not because of the complexity, but because it wasn't broken.
Yeah.
Which is so rare nowadays.
Which is also an important part of game direction.
Yeah.
Yes.
Getting a finished product out.
All of that said, it should be Baldur's Gate 3. They're going to give it to Alan Wake 2.
Okay. So I'm saying Baldur's Gate. Josh is saying Alan Wake. Jason?
You know, I've only played two of these games. I would have to say I'd go with Baldur's Gate.
Okay. Yeah. I think that's a safe bet, but Josh does have a good argument.
My arguments usually are.
You know, one of the things that's the best about working with Josh is that he's not very aggressive with his opinions. He's very honest.
All right. All right. Let's move on to best
Final
narrative.
Fantasy XVI, whatever that is.
Best narrative. We have Alan Wake 2, Baldur's Gate 3, Cyberpunk 2077, Phantom Liberty, which is its own nomination, Final Fantasy 16, and Marvel's Spider-Man 2. So obviously for outstanding storytelling and narrative development in a game. And I think this is where Alan Wake gets its win, is best narrative.
You said this was Cyberpunk's only nomination?
Yeah.
It's going to be Cyberpunk.
Well, mm-hmm. Aside from the performance category, which is...
Yeah, it's going to be Cyberpunk.
Okay. Yeah, I'm saying Alan Wake 2. Josh is on Cyberpunk, Phantom Liberty. Jason?
You know, again, this goes to me only playing two of these games. Final Fantasy 16. Had a really good narrative for me.
Final Fantasy does have good stories.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so we're actually split across the board on that one. That's interesting. Who's going to... Whoever wins the most, where do we win? I feel like we should get a prize if we guess the majority of these right.
Leave a comment. What should... Yeah, leave a comment.
Obviously, it would be a gift card to Taco Bell.
Right, because when you're gaming, you're belling. Taco belling.
You're belling. All right.
Bell on.
All right, best art direction. This is Alan Wake 2, Hi-Fi Rush, Lies of P, Super Mario Brothers Wonder, and The Legend of Zelda Tears of the Kingdom. So obviously for outstanding creative and or technical achievement in artistic design and animation. I'm saying Hi-Fi Rush.
It should be Hi-Fi Rush. It's going to be Zelda.
I'm with Josh on this one. It's going to be Zelda.
Hi-Fi Rush was so
it like... It should be Hi-Fi Rush. I started it by saying it should be Hi-Fi Rush.
I hear you.
It's going to be Zelda. Because it's Zelda, and it's cute, and it's cartoony, and they're going to act like they've never seen that before, even though the last six Zelda games looked exactly like that.
That's why it doesn't win to me. Like, it doesn't do anything new.
Well, also that the ability to create your own stuff is going to be part
art,
of that.
That's not the art direction.
It is art.
Category,
it allows the user to participate in the creation of
you have a hand
artwork
in the art of the game.
Yep.
But did you guys play Hi-Fi Rush?
I haven't played any of these that are listed out here. I'm just
It was so amazing. This was the game I kind of talked to you guys about when it first came out.
Yeah, we know.
Where it was like the entire game.
It was on Microsoft, right?
Yeah, it is exclusive to Xbox.
Yeah.
But like the entire game is based on music. It's like every single move you make, your character is like reacting to the music you're hearing, like the entire environment's reacting to the music. But it's also like a shell-shaded like type of art style. It's so good. They had to put so much work into that game. Hey, it's got to win for me.
What's one of your biggest hobbies, Corey? What's one of your biggest Corey's?
What's one of your biggest Corey's hobby?
Me. What are you trying to say? What are you trying to say?
I'm just saying that there might be a little bias.
For the best game in this category.
I mean,
it's going to be Legend of Zelda.
Yeah, you guys are saying Legends of Zelda. I'm saying Hi-Fi Rush. Let's move on.
We're saying Legends of Felda. Yes.
Shut up. All right. Best score and music. Alan Wake 2, Baldur's Gate 3, Final Fantasy 16, Hi-Fi Rush, The Legends of Zelda, Tears of the Kingdom.
I've only played one of these games, so I can't decide.
Obviously, it's for outstanding music, inclusive of score, original song, and or licensed soundtrack. So yet again, I'm going Hi-Fi Rush just because the entire game was based on music.
I'll give you Hi-Fi Rush on that one because that is like the crux of the game, like you're saying. Yeah.
Sure.
All right. Cool. Glad we're in agreement. All right.
Sure. Whatever. I don't care.
Best audio design. So before we even get into the nominees... it's for recognizing the best in-game audio and okay, that's like the worst definition.
the best in-game audio and design.
Yeah, it's for like best atmospheric sound, so like voiceovers, but also environmental sound, stuff like that. So it's Alan Wake 2, Dead Space, Hi-Fi Rush, Marvel's Spider-Man 2, and Resident Evil 4.
Is this Spider-Man. Dead Space's only category?
It is.
It'll be Dead Space.
Yeah, I think I'm just because. Oh, interesting. Yeah, I have to agree with Josh. I think just, you know, I said this in my review when it came out, that the sound has so much to do with setting the tone of the atmosphere for making this a horror game. So I think that's the one. But Jason, you're saying Spider-Man 2?
Yeah, so I'm going to point to one thing in Spider-Man. Now, and this is the thing that I think really sells me on it. So I don't use headsets when I play games. It's just me in my room, and I don't even have surround sound. I just have the regular TV speaker. Hang on. This is why it's important. So when you're playing Spider-Man, there's these boxes that hold tech equipment. And as you swing through the city, you hear them, and that's how you find them.
Yeah.
Using just the controller, I was able to find these things with directional sound. So the fact that I was able to do that with a direction, an audio direction, without a headset, I think speaks volumes to how well the sound design is. So taking that, and then on top of all the different ways that they portray multimedia when you're listening to podcasts and newscasts and phone calls, and as you're swinging through the city, the sounds that you hear as you're flying and whooshing through the city, and as you hear the people as you go by,
a good whoosh.
Yeah, the whoosh. Yeah, I mean, and then of course there's the main sounds, the gameplay sounds that are nothing has been everything has been very immersive for me in that game without a headset. So that's why I'm just getting my vote.
Okay, it'll be Dead Space 2, or Dead Space rather, Dead Space the remake.
Yes, I hear you, Jason. I hear you.
Yeah. Am I? Well, you play with a headset, so you wouldn't know. But never mind.
Sorry, okay. I let you down. All right. Best performance. So we're actually talking about real people here. Mm-hmm. This is awarded to an individual for voiceover acting, motion, and or performance capture. So we have Ben Starr from Final Fantasy 16. We have Cameron Monaghan from Star Wars Jedi Survivor.
Monaghan,
sure.
I don't know why you got weird in the middle
of that. Idris Elba for Cyberpunk 2077 and Phantom Liberty.
Idris Elba.
Yeah, I was gonna say it's gonna be Idris Elba, but you can keep reading if you want to. It's gonna be Idris Elba.
We got Melanie Libert from Alan Wake 2. We got Neil Newbon from Baldur's Gate 3, and Yuri Lowenthal from Marvel's Spider-Man 2.
Idris Elba.
Now, is it just Idris Elba because they want a big name star there, or do you guys actually think he deserved it?
I want him to win. Period.
Yes. Oh. First off, I love Idris Elba. I just do. But also, yeah, part of any show is hype. You want people to freak out when you bring Idris Elba out. That's not to say that other people on the list did not do a great job.
Oh, yeah.
They did. Cameron Monaghan is a great actor. He's never done anything badly. Yuri Lowenthal, I feel bad that Spider-Man no longer looks like him.
Oh.
He got Tom Holland did.
I think he won for the first game, if I remember correctly. Mm.
I think it's going to be Idris Elba.
I think it's Neil Newbon for Baldur's Gate 3.
Okay. He played the vampire, right?
I believe so, yes.
Yes, the sexually ambiguous vampire.
Yes.
Didn't Saturday Night Live do a skit about... Oh, wait, never mind. That was a duo. Never mind. Okay.
Never mind. Maybe. We'll see. That's going to be a toss-up for me. But I'm saying him. All right. So let's move on to best ongoing game. So, to define this is awarded to a game for outstanding development of ongoing content that evolves the player experience over time. So, Apex Legends, Cyberpunk 2077, Final Fantasy
16.
Nope.
No, 14.
14. Sorry. They changed up those letters there. Fortnite and Genshin and Impact. Mm. So, I got to say Cyberpunk 2077 just because it's a vastly different game than it was when it first came out.
It should be Cyberpunk 2077.
But it's going to be?
It's going to be Fortnite.
That's the one I was going to say too. Yeah.
Especially since they just launched Lego Fortnite.
It's coming out soon. But no, I think it's going to be Cyberpunk just because I think people want to...
It should be Cyberpunk.
I think they want to reward all the hard work the team has been putting to fix this game.
It should be Cyberpunk.
I think it's going to be
Cyberpunk. It's going to be Fortnite.
Okay. I'll let you have that one.
But... And I say that as someone who is so over Fortnite. Yeah. It is the world's most literal cash grab.
So basically, this game is just called 2 weeks. Is that what we're saying?
What?
Fortnite.
Ah.
Ah.
I hate you, Jason. All right. So Fortnite and Cyberpunk, we'll see which one wins. Let's move on to best community support. This is a relatively new category, I believe. Recognizing a game for outstanding community support, transparency, and responsiveness, inclusive of social media activity and game updates / patches. So Baldur's Gate 3, Cyberpunk 2077, Destiny 2, Final Fantasy 14, and No Man's Sky. I'm going Cyberpunk on this 14. One again.
So the best panderer of the year is, I'm going to say Destiny.
So this is the tough one because Bungie just laid off a bunch of their team from Destiny 2.
And as a consumer, that has nothing to do with me.
I know, it's
Destiny 2.
It's just a touchy subject.
I'm saying Destiny 2.
All right. So yet again, we're split across the board in that one.
People love Destiny.
They do.
Also, if we're being totally honest, the game that most deserves it is probably No Man's Sky. You want to talk about a game that is completely different than when it launched almost a decade ago?
It wasn't that long ago, was it?
It was a pretty long time ago. probably worth a Google. No Man's Sky came out a long time ago, and it is a super different game now than it was when it launched.
I'm going to stop right here. Let's just go
fucking up right now.
2016.
So yeah, heading towards a decade ago, 8 years ago.
So yeah, I'm mostly right.
Heading mostly towards right. A decade. I'm 80% correct.
I'm right.
Which if you is round a up. Good threshold for me. I'm fine with 80% correct.
If we're going by fives and round up, it's 10 years. Yeah. So yeah.
Point is, not a new game by any stretch of the imagination.
You're right.
But people keep playing it every new iteration. It deserves to be best community support. But it's going to be Destiny 2.
All right. Okay.
It's going to be Final Fantasy 14.
It's going to be Cyberpunk. Anyway, let's move on to best independent game.
I haven't played a single one of them. We could skip this category. Well,
for outstanding creative and technical achievement in a game made outside the traditional publisher's system. I'm going... Oh, sorry. I should probably read them. Cocoon, Dave the Diver, Dredge, Sea of Stars, Viewfinder. I'm saying Cocoon.
I'm going to say Dave the Diver was the highest rated.
Sure. I got all nothing.
Right. All right, good. All right, we're just moving on. Here we go.
I do feel bad, though, because some independent games are like outstanding, and they just...
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I just haven't played
under
any.
The radar.
Yeah.
Because yeah.
I do not have enough time to play an independent game.
I barely have enough time to play
like the two or three AAAs that come out a year.
Right.
So I'm sorry. I have time for this. Game. Yeah, like...
All right, well, best debut indie game. So this is for the best debut game created by a new independent studio. Cocoon, Dredge, Pizza Tower, Venba, and Viewfinder. I'm saying Cocoon again.
Tell me about Cocoon.
I don't know. Cocoon.
Okay.
We don't know anything about these games. Corey, Corey did not.
It looks beautiful, so that's why I'm saying it.
Yeah, Cocoon. We'll go with Cocoon.
What does Pizza Tower look like? I'm going to say Pizza Tower. Dude looks stressed out. I relate to that.
Apparently, Pizza Tower does have a pretty big following, so that is a strong contender. All right, so now we're getting into the last couple of categories. We have three more. All right, so we're going into best adaptations. This is talking about movies and television shows. So we have Castlevania Nocturne. We have Gran Turismo, The Last of Us, the Super Mario Brothers movie, and Twisted Metal.
Point of order.
Yes.
Well, point of inquiry, because it's a question.
Okay.
So... Robert's Rules of Order. So this is not judging the game. This is judging the content based on the game.
Recognizing outstanding creative work that faithfully and authentically adapts a video game to another entertainment medium.
So, Super Mario Brothers movie.
Last of Us.
I gotta go Last of Us.
Like, Last of Us was good. It was... I would say it was not a faithful adaptation.
But it captured the feeling.
Yeah, aside from the part where it had zombies and stuff. Or rather, didn't.
But they are not zombies, Josh.
It was a video game adaptation that removed the primary antagonist of the video games.
No. You play Last of Us. What the primary antagonist is? People is how horrible people.
Yeah, are. The people who want to eat you.
No, it's how horrible we are to each other, and that is
no.
Definitely
that's The Walking Dead. This. You're getting your fuses crossed.
I am not.
I'm saying The Last of Us. I thought it was a faithful adaptation. I'm going to give a shout out to
I'm sorry, that third episode wrecked everybody.
It was not even remotely faithful, but it's
the best adaptation, too, though. It's like...
See, that's what I'm saying, though. It has nothing to do with what I thought of the show. Was the show a faithful adaptation of the game?
But is that how people were voting, though? Or was it just the best quality thing they were watching? That's what I'm saying. I think
Super Mario
people Brothers, voting for this category would agree The Last of Us was the best quality of all of these.
I believe in Chris Pratt.
Okay, so when you read the best adaptation description, read it again, please.
Recognizing outstanding creative work that faithfully and authentically adapts a video game to another entertainment medium.
That is actually the primary stipulation, is that it authentically does it.
Yeah.
And
Super Mario Brothers.
But I'm just saying, do people vote that way?
Honestly, Gran Turismo, because all it is racing. So all you gotta do is have some racing in it.
And apparently that movie wasn't trash. So I don't know. Yeah. That could be a contender. I believe it's between The Last of Us and Super Mario Brothers.
I think Last of Us is gonna win.
Okay. And yet Super again, Mario I want to give a shout out to Twisted Metal because I loved that show. It was awesome. It didn't really have anything to do with the game, but it was awesome. Highly recommend.
Anthony Mackie is funny as hell.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Like I didn't like, I thought he, yeah, he was pretty damn funny. I thought he'd need somebody to jump off of like Sebastian Stan. No, he's got it all by himself too. He's good.
Oh, yeah, he does. All right. Two more. So now we're talking about future games. So the most anticipated game, these are games coming out likely next
this
year.
This is a weird, this is a weird,
weird
category. Yeah, like, yeah. We're, like, it's not even out yet, but who's going to win?
Recognizing an unannounced game that has demonstrably illustrated potential to push the gaming medium forward. So we have Final Fantasy VII Rebirth.
That is such a BS description.
Right?
It has nothing to do with whether or not it's going to push the medium forward. It has to do with which game are you most excited about.
Yep.
Which is why I'm going to say Star Wars.
Before it sounds like somebody tried to make up a Star mission Wars. Statement on the fly, honestly.
Correct. Yes. This was a guy who's trying to get an A on his paper.
Right. Okay.
So Final Fantasy VII Rebirth, Hades 2, Like a Dragon, Infinite Wealth, Star Wars Outlaws, and Tekken 8.
It's Star Wars. Why are we acting like it's anything other than Star Wars?
Because it's Final Fantasy VII Rebirth.
Yeah, I want it to be Final Fantasy VII Rebirth.
It's going to be Star Wars.
But I don't think it's going to be Final Fantasy VII Rebirth.
It's going to be Star Wars.
Yeah.
People always get crunk about a Star Wars game because every gamer in the back of their head has that one Star Wars game that like defined their childhood. So anytime we announce a Star Wars game, we get super excited about it and completely forget that the last 87 Star Wars games have been trash.
The last one was good.
It's going to be Star Wars.
I'm switching to Final Fantasy VII Rebirth.
There you go. Just because of Josh.
No. As you were talking, I kind of tuned out and was thinking about... No, I'm kidding.
I'm 80% right.
No, I was thinking about the things you were saying, though, and they actually talked to me more. It spoke to me more as it relates to Final Fantasy VII.
I think
Final Fantasy there's a lot of people really anticipating this one coming out. Yeah. Final Fantasy VII coming out.
So here's my line of thinking.
Yes.
Final Fantasy VII is a genre and age-defining video game.
Right.
Unrivaled in its industry.
That's correct.
Star Wars goes beyond the gaming industry.
But not in the gaming industry. It does not have as much influence as Final Fantasy VII does, almost specifically.
Don't doubt the House of Mouse, bro. Don't doubt the House of
Mouse.
I'm
going Final Fantasy. I don't know.
I'm sticking to my guns here.
Now, my personal one I'm looking forward to is Star Wars Outlaws. It looks awesome. But I'm thinking Final Fantasy wins.
It's going to be Star Wars. We're all wrong. It's going to be Tekken 8.
Yeah, right.
Like, wow, we were off base on that one.
All right. Moving into the last category. You've guessed what it is. It's the best game of the year.
And the nominees are
Alan Wake 2, Baldur's Gate 3, Marvel's Spider-Man 2, Resident Evil 4, Super Mario Brothers Wonder, and The Legend of Zelda, Tears of the Kingdom. Can we just say that Resident Evil 4 is just kind of like an
underdog? No one gives a crap.
Like, no one, like, yeah, it's just in, like, for a consolation. Like, it's...
I was going to say like it's a dark horse, but a dark horse means that it may have an ability to
win. There's no chance it wins.
Yeah.
It's just an honor to be nominated, really.
Yeah. I'm going Baldur's Gate 3.
It should be Baldur's Gate 3. It should
be Zelda. How many times have you said that tonight?
It's going to be Zelda.
It should be Baldur's Gate 3. It's going to be Zelda. Every year that a Zelda game comes out, the industry flips doo-doo.
I don't know.
It doesn't matter that it didn't really change anything. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. It will be Zelda.
I think it's Baldur's Gate.
It should be Baldur's Gate. It will be Zelda.
I think it's Baldur's Gate. The interesting thing is that on Metacritic, Baldur's Gate 3 and Legend of Zelda Tears of the Kingdom had the exact same score of a 96.
Oh, interesting.
So, this could be a toss-up. It could be a tie. I don't know if we've ever had a tie before, but...
I think it should be a tie.
I don't know.
It's going to be Zelda.
Yeah.
It should be Baldur's Gate. Well.
So what I've learned is that I've played a really embarrassingly few video games this year.
Well, really, it was the same three or four titles over and over and over again. So actually, you don't have to play that many to catch up with the best of the year.
But even then, I still didn't.
I played a surprising amount of these. But yeah, that wraps us up. So I believe The entire team is getting together this weekend to do another episode, and we will be recording that just after these awards are announced. So we might be doing a little follow-up discussion to see who predicted most of these correct. I think I'm going to win. Just saying. Any thoughts going into this awards show?
Should have been Baldur's Gate.
It's going to be Baldur's Gate. Baldur's Gate's going to win a lot of these awards, I think. Yeah.
No, it's going to be the great snuff.
It was such a marvel. It was unique. Nope. It was rare for a game to be this good. Yeah, that one.
80% right.
I think Baldur's Gate's going to win most of its noms. But we shall see. So these awards are happening December 7th. Hopefully the next episode we have will be discussing the winners. But in the meantime, don't forget to go to our YouTube channel, youtube.com/@eatsleepnerd. Click the subscribe button, click the like buttons, leave some comments. Let us know what you're predicting will win at this week's video game awards. Obviously, before the awards happen, or else you're just cheating. But also, share us with some friends, some family, some neighbors, your daughters, sons, dogs, cats, turtles. I don't know. But also, Jason.
Hamsters.
Yeah, hamsters too. Don't leave them out. What are three things nerds should be doing before next week?
Well, one of the things I did want to remind them was leave a comment on what we should win if we win.
Oh, yeah.
Between the three of us. Don't forget about that.
Talk about it a little.
But anyway, what you should be doing, the things that we may not have been doing as well as we should have been recently, is eat, sleep, and nerd.
Take it easy, people.